In this video, I'm going to take you through our solar PV and Tesla Powerwall 2 performance for September 2020 here in the UK, along with our Tesla Model 3 and Kona Electric costs and usage. So stay tuned. Hi, John here and welcome. As I said in the intro, in this video, I'm going to take you through our solar PV and Tesla Powerwall 2 performance for the month of September 2020, plus the usual stats and usage information for the Tesla Model 3, the Hyundai Kona, and our MyEnergy, Eddy and Zappy components. Incidentally, I've recorded a separate video on 12 months ownership of the Tesla Model 3. It turned a year old on the 28th of September, and I'll put a link to that up here and also down in the video description. If you recall, in our August video, I told you that our comms hub on our electric SMETS2 smart meter had died, and it was having a power cycle on the 6th of October, which is next week. I'm recording this on Friday, the 2nd of October. So hopefully that will fix it, but I'll do you an update in due course on that. So yeah, both gas and electric now aren't reading data through to Octopus. If you're not familiar with our setup, we're based in the UK, but again, all the details are down below in the description. So have a look down there to all the component parts, the sizes, the specs, all of that kind of thing. So on to September's performance. Let's have a look at our monthly PV generation totals. So in September, we produced a total of 696 kilowatt hours from our two separate arrays. We had a daily average generation of 23.2 kilowatt hours for the month, which is almost identical to August's total, which is actually good for this time of year, because often September trails behind August in terms of the totals, as well as the way the months run. So let me know in the comment section down below how you got on with your solar generation, because I'd really like to hear what your totals were and your system and your components, etc. Plus, everyone else likes to have a look as well. So, you know, you're sharing with the wilder community. It might be wild, but it's also wider. So let's have a look at our split of our both arrays. So our 4 kilowatt array, original solar array, produced 434 kilowatt hours, and our newer 2.34 kilowatt array produced 262 kilowatt hours. And those figures are within a gnat's whisker of August totals, as you can see there from the chart. If we look at the percentage contribution of the Powerwall 2 and our solar to our overall self-power, bring that chart up for you. Our Powerwall is in cost-saving mode, which is when it's kept in there from when we swapped it in August. It was on self-powered mode, and in the middle of August, we moved it across to cost-saving. As I mentioned in that last video, in the August video, is that it's probably going to stay on that mode until the early summer of 2021. We are with Octopus Energy on the Agile tariff, and often the unit of electricity during peak is around 25 to 30 pence per unit of electricity. So in the cost-saving mode, the battery provides the power to the house during that peak period from 4 p.m. to 7 p.m. Powerwall can provide a 5 kilowatt continuous load or up to 7 kilowatts for a quick burst. So for the month of September, we were 64% self-powered from the Powerwall and solar combined, the both contributions, which is about the same as September 2019, when it was 66% self-powered for the month. In September 2020, 41% came from solar, and 23% came from the Powerwall. And looking at the figures, you can certainly see the drop in solar production here against last month, if you look at August last month. And also, if you compare it to September 2019 to September 2020, you will see a difference in solar contribution. So less solar contribution in 2019, but more battery usage to supply the house demand. Let's have a look at the peak and off-peak for that self-power, see how that split out. And the Powerwall did a good job of managing our power usage at peak period. So let me show you that chart. This is the monthly figures for the Powerwall supplying the house rather than the house pulling from the grid. The months along the bottom are only populated with data when we are in cost-saving mode with the Powerwall too. So this allows me to track how effective it was at powering the house during that peak and off-peak periods. As you can see, we were 98% self-powered during that peak time of 4 p.m. to 7 p.m. And off-peak, the Powerwall was able to supply a home usage for 29% of the total amount of time over the month. The reason for the lower figure compared to August's 49% during off-peak will become apparent when we have a look at the day-by-day chart in a minute. If we move on to have a look on the year-on-year chart, here is September's solar generation, and that goes back to 2011. So the totals for 2011 through 2019 are original 4 kilowatt system. The 2020 figure is for both arrays. If you recall, our original array produced 434 kilowatt hours in September of this year, making it actually our third best September over the 10 years that we've been recording the data. Let's move on, have a look at our Powerwall in and out. Powerwall did well this month. It had a round trip efficiency of 92% based on what it managed to store versus what it was able to supply. So we stored 248 kilowatt hours into the battery and it supplied 229 kilowatt hours. The input was the same as August, but we managed to pull just slightly more out, another 12 kilowatt hours over the course of the month comparing it to August. So let's look at that day by day chart. So this chart gives you certainly a lot more detail of what happened day by day to our usage. The key or the legend is blue is our house usage, yellow is solar production, red is what's been pulled from the grid, and orange is excess exported back to the grid. You'll see there's a lot of blue there. We used lots of power this month, basically. The house used lots of power. We charged the Tesla Model 3 much more in September compared to previous months, with most of it coming from the grid. We certainly use the car much more, which you'll see in a bit when we have a look at the Model 3 stats, which is coming up. But I guess also not being able to make the most of the sunshine as we were out during the day in the car. This meant we exported perhaps a little bit more solar production than we wanted to because we were away and we couldn't use it. So for me, the takeaway is never leave the house, or if you do, leave the house when it's dark. So let's have a look at those days. Let's pick out some of the key ones. If you look at the 1st, the 8th, 17th, the 18th, the 24th and the 25th, all those days we charged the car from grid power. Typically, that would have been in the early hours of the morning when the electricity prices were cheap. Because our smart meter is no longer smart, I can't actually give you the exact costs of those charging activities. However, the unit rates varied between 2 pence per kilowatt hour to 7 pence per kilowatt hour when we were actually charging the car. So I made sure that I did charge it. When I did charge it, it was no more than 7 pence per kilowatt hour for our unit rate. We've also been running at least one of our kilns almost every day, be that each night or during the day. And that's again for most of the month. So I guess depending on the program that the kilns are actually running, they typically consume about 5 kilowatt hours of electricity for each firing from sort of start to finish. This works out on average based on the price of electricity when we're actually running the kilns at about 7 pence per kilowatt hour. So it's like 35 pence to run the kiln, basically. So it's only not clearing out our bank account when we're running the kilns, which is good to know. So I guess in summary of that day-to-day, we had very high house usage, more reliance on the grid, and in some cases we were less effective in using the solar energy, mainly because we were out. So let's have a look at the overall totals quickly for September with this chart here. So that shows you the four data sources, and we'll look at some more in a little bit more detail in a second. So the house usage is the key one, at 1,090 kilowatt hours for the month, which compare that to August, which was 860. We've already looked at the solar production. We're about to look in more detail about the grid import and export. So they're there, but I'm just not going to dwell on them. Which leads me neatly on to talk about our daily average grid usage and house usage chart. So this chart tracks our average daily house usage and our average daily grid usage. As you can see here, our average daily house usage is up at 36.3, and this ties in what I've already told you about our increase in usage. Our average daily pull from the grid was also higher at 15.2 kilowatt hours, double what we did in August. What we sent to the grid, let's have a look at that. So we sent 79.3 kilowatt hours of excess solar generated back to the grid in September, which actually is less than August. So, you know, that is a positive. The export total is really made up of very small amounts of surplus each day that we were unable to make use of. So what I found is once the hot water was heated up by excess solar, once the battery was 100% state of charge, then 2 to 3 kilowatt hours would trickle back to the grid over the day, unless we were at home and the car was plugged in and charging. The Kona, because we didn't use it much in the month, had 80% state of charge for the month, so there was pointless trying to push more juice into that. So it sort of goes back to my earlier point about never leaving the house during the daytime. If we go down and have a look at the monthly totals from the grid chart. So in September, we pulled a total of 455 kilowatt hours from the grid. It's almost twice as much as we did in August. And I've always already mentioned the reasons for the extra grid usage, so I won't repeat myself here. In terms of the eddy, for the month of September, the eddy diverted 45 kilowatt hours of excess solar energy to heat our hot water. And that's all we use to heat our hot water. We don't use any additional gas or anything like that. So this gives us a year-to-date total of 353 kilowatt hours. We have an accumulative total since installation on the 22nd of July 2019 of 426 kilowatt hours. I've taken the cost savings of £2.66 that I've listed there based on 5p per kilowatt hour, which I think I said before last month was probably a little on the low side, because the average agile price is around 8p per kilowatt hour over the 24-hour period. Anyway, leave it at that. Onto the Zappy and the cars. So the Tesla Model 3 basically doubled our last month's total of 731 miles covered during the month. And we did a very credible 1,433 miles. And that brings its overall total to 6,583 miles. The Kona covered just 134 miles in the month, and now has a total of 10,322 miles. The Kona hasn't been charged at all during the month because we didn't use it. It was very much 130 miles, so it didn't have much impact at all on its charge. So the Model 3 has been the backbone, I guess, for the month. The Model 3 has had 5 supercharging sessions. Much of that was down to an issue we had of being unable to supercharge, which meant there was a bit of post-fix testing. And there's a link to that video up there if you want to know all about that. And there's also one that follows it, which is the fix to what the problem was. So yeah, they're up there if you want to go and have a look at those. So the 5 supercharging sessions added 182.07 kilowatt hours to the Tesla at no cost. because of our referral miles for our Tesla. So it is a real thank you to those of you who have used our referral code, as we both benefit from a thousand supercharging miles each. Code's coming up down there. So if you're thinking of getting a Tesla, then perhaps consider using my code. That would be muchly appreciated. It'll benefit us both. On the Zappy point of view, from charging at home, we added 397.87 kilowatt hours to the Model 3. And as you can see from this picture, the split between the grid and energy was 42% green, and the remaining was 58%, which came from the grid. This cost us £13.76 to use the grid for those 229.39 kilowatt hours, which is how much we pushed in. And this is based on our 6 pence per kilowatt hour on the Agile tariff, which was when we would have charged the Tesla overnight. Again, I've had to sort of guesstimate this on our smart meter as it's broken. So I know we only charged in the early hours when the price was around 6 pence to 7 pence per kilowatt hour. So it's fairly accurate, but it's not bob on the money, but you get the flavour. So if we push that into our 1,433 miles covered during the month, it's cost us £0.01 per mile. So that's it. Please comment and like, as those actions means that the video gets shown to more people. It's all about engagement on YouTube. So yeah, thanks for watching, and I will see you on the next video. All right, take care. Bye.